CB approached the High Court and instituted an application against the respondents, Ms. Nomgcobo Jiba, Mr. Lawrence Mrwebi, and Mr. Sibongile Mzinyathi. In that application, the GCB sought an order to remove the respondents who hold various senior positions in the Office of the National Prosecuting Authority from the role of advocates. In the alternative, the GCB sought an order that suspended them from practicing as advocates. The application by the GCB arose from the complaints which emanated from how the respondents had conducted themselves in three cases, namely Boysen v. Acting National Director of Public Prosecutions, Freedom Under Law v. National Director of Public Prosecutions, and Zuma versus Democratic Alliance. The High Court found that Ms. Jiba and Mr. Mrwebi were not fit and proper persons to remain on the role of advocates. This finding related to their conduct in the Mdluli case. Regarding the Boysen case, the High Court held that no case had been made out for the removal or suspension of the respondents from the role. The High Court subsequently granted an order to the effect that the names of Ms. Jiba and Mr. Mrwebi be struck from the role, but dismissed the application against Mr. Mzinyathi with cause. Aggrieved by the High Court's decision, Ms. Jiba and Mr. Mrwebi appealed to the SCA, whilst the GCB cross-appealed against the cause order relating to Mr. Mzinyathi's application. The majority of the SCA ruled that the GCB failed to establish the alleged offending conduct on the part of Ms. Jiba. Consequently, there was no need to deal with a value judgment to determine whether she was a fit and proper person to remain on the role of advocates. With regard to Mr. Mrwebi, the majority was satisfied that the misconduct had been established and that he was not fit and proper to practice as an advocate. However, the majority found that the striking off from the role sanction, which was imposed by the High Court, was inappropriate, given that he did not personally gain anything from his actions. The GCB's cross-appeal was dismissed by the majority. Contrary to the minority concluded that Ms. Jiba and Mr. Mrwebi's appeals should be dismissed, and the cross-appeal against the court's order should be upheld. In this court, the GCB sought leave to appeal against the order of the Supreme Court of Appeal. The first issue that needed to be established was whether this court has jurisdiction to adjudicate the matter. It was the GCB's contention that this matter raises constitutional issues, given that the interpretation and application of the NPA Act is called for. Moreover, the GCB submitted that an arguable point of law of general public importance is raised. In a unanimous judgment written by myself, concurred in by Mukwen C.J., Cameron J., Freneman J., Khampepe J., Lidwaba A.J., Madlanga J., Tlantla J., Nichols A.J., and Theron J., this court holds that the GCB has not established that this matter falls within its jurisdiction. This court concludes that the GCB's cause of action was based on Section 7 of the Admissions Act and nothing else. Consequently, this court holds that the interpretation and application of the Admission Act does not in this matter raise a constitutional issue. This court further finds that the GCB did not seek to protect a constitutional right. Instead, all that it sought to do was to enforce the Admission Act so as to protect the public and preserve the proper functioning of the administration of justice. The apparently incorrect determination of facts by the majority in the Supreme Court of Appeal also does not raise a constitutional issue. If what is at issue in a particular case is the determination of facts, then the jurisdiction of this court is not engaged. Concerning the NPA Act, this court concludes that the claim advanced by the GCB is a self-standing claim, given that it is based as it is within the four corners of the Admission Act. As a result, the NPA Act finds no application in this matter, since it does not regulate the admission of advocates. In addition, this court holds that the assertion by the GCB that this matter raises an arguable point of law of general public importance has no substance. Of importance to note in this regard is that the divergence between the majority and the minority in the Supreme Court of Appeal did not flow from the application of legal principles, but from an evaluation of the facts. With respect to the cross-appeal, this court acknowledges that reliance on Section 9, sub 1 of the Constitution by the majority in the Supreme Court of Appeal clothed this court with jurisdiction in that regard. However, the principle that cause follow the result is not applicable to proceedings of this nature, as such proceedings are initiated in the interests of the general public. This court emphasizes that the GCB's role in instituting these proceedings is to enable the High Court to exercise its disciplinary powers. It follows that an order of course against the GCB is permissible only in circumstances where it has conducted itself in a manner unacceptable to the court before which proceedings are brought. Consequently, this court holds that although the appeal on the merits has failed, the GCB should not be ordered to pay costs. In addition, this court further holds that even though the GCB has succeeded in having the cost order made against it overturned, it is fair not to order the respondents to pay its costs too. Given these considerations, it is concluded that an order as to cause need not be made. In the result, the following order is made. 1. The application for leave to appeal against the merits is dismissed. 2. Leave is granted against the cost orders. 3. The order of the Supreme Court of Appeal that dismissed the counter appeal with cost is set aside. 4. The order of the High Court that required the General Counsel of the Bar of South Africa to pay costs is set aside. 5. There is no order as to costs. I hand down the judgment. Please. The court adjourns.